Good afternoon. In the previous class, we have seen an introduction to databases, and we have also seen how we can have a relation, and we have seen a few of the words which are like tables, records, and fields. So we have seen a table, which is this, where we have seen that a database consists of records, which are n tuples made up of fields. The fields are the entries of the n tuples. So each of them is known as a field. For instance, a database of student record may be made up of fields containing the student name, student number, major, and the grade point of the student. The relational data model represents a database of records as an NRE relation, that is, which we have seen in the earlier class. That is, we have four relations over here. That is, the degree of this relation is four. Since we have four different sets, we will have a set of names, a set of numbers, a set of major, and a set of GPA. Okay. The student records are represented as four tuples of the form student name, ID number, major, and GPA. These tables, because these relations are often displayed as tables, each column of the table is known as an attribute. Now, what is an attribute? It specifies some property. So, this column specifies the property of the student name, while this is the property of the roll numbers, etc. For instance, the same database, this database, the attributes are, each of these is known as an attribute. Student name is an attribute, ID number is an attribute, major and GPA are also attributes. Now, a domain of an NRE relation is called a primary key. Okay, a domain of an NRE relation is called a primary key if the n tuples are uniquely determined by their values from this domain. Now, to make it simple, suppose if we are taking this table, the primary key is usually the roll number or the ID number, because there might be two students in the class with the name Adams or Rao or Stevens or any of the names, but the roll number or the ID number given to each student will be unique. That is, whenever we are considering a primary key, which you will actually study later in database management system subject in detail, but for now, remember that whenever you are considering a primary key, it should be unique. Each tuple should have a unique primary key. That is, a domain is a primary key. Whenever you are taking an attribute, no two values or fields in that attribute should be the same. Then only that can be considered as a primary key. That is, a domain is a primary key when no two n tuples in the relation have the same value or they should be unique. Now, records are usually added or deleted from the database. So, suppose if a student has left the college or the university, we have to delete that student record. Or else, if a student has enrolled in the college, then we have to add. So, records are usually added or even deleted from the database. Because of this, the property that a domain is a primary key is time dependent, and we should choose a primary key that remains whenever the database is changed. Now, when selecting a primary key, the goal should be that we are supposed to select a key that can serve as a key for all the additional rows or columns. So suppose if we are selecting ID number as the primary key, then suppose if we are adding another student's record, the primary key should be the ID number only. That is, he should be given a unique ID number and not some ID number which is already existing for a student. Now, based on this, we've already seen this. In our example, which is the primary key, we can take student name and ID number are primary keys, but if suppose we are adding another student name with the same name, suppose there is another Adams in the class, then we cannot have student name as the primary key. So it is usually in a real student database, only ID number would be a primary key. This is important. Now, after that, in a database, a primary key should remain one even if the new records are added. Therefore, we should use the primary key of the intention of the database. Combinations of domains can also uniquely identify. Suppose if you are taking the ID number or the student name and the department name or the CGPA, then all you can also take that. So combination can also be taken as a primary key. When we are taking the combination, when the values of a set of a domain determine an n tuple, then these kind of values are called as composite. We can apply a variety of operations on NRA relations to form new relations. So the first operation, okay, is before we study projection, actually we will study something known as selection. So the most basic operation on NRA relation is determining all n tuples in the NRA relation that satisfy certain conditions. Okay, so suppose if I want all the students who have scored more than 3 CGPA, then that condition is the students more than greater than 3 GPA or CGPA. Then for example, or we can find all the CS, computer science students, or we may want to find the computer science students who have greater than 3 GPA. So to perform all such kinds of tasks, we have something known as selection operator. To perform the task, we have to check for a specific condition, we have the selection operator. Now, what is the selection operator? Let R be an NRA relation and C is a condition that the elements in R may satisfy. Then the selection operator SC maps the NRA relation R to the NRA relation of all n tuples that satisfy the condition. Now, let's take an example. To find the records of computer science majors in our table that we have seen already, where the condition is we have to find all the computer science major students. Let's see. So in this case, who are the computer science students? Ackerman and Chow. So the result that we will get when we perform the selection of operator is we will get a table with only two rows. One will be the Ackerman row and the other will be the Chow row. Or we can also get the result in this form. So we will get the result in this form. Ackerman, his ID number, whatever it is, his department obviously will be, the major will be computer science, and the grade point is. And similarly, we will get the Chow's row, whatever his ID number, department we know because we are specifying that we want only CS majors and his GPA. Similarly, to find the records of the students who have grade point or GPA more than 3, whoever has grade point more than 3, we can get the same. So please try to pause the video, go back and draw the table in your notebook and perform the selection operation for the grade point greater than 3. Now moving on, we have the next thing, projection. In other words, basically what a projection is, the projection are used to form new NRE relations by deleting the same fields in every record of the relation. Now what does this mean? The projection PI1, I2 and so on up to IM maps the N tuple A1, A2 and so on up to AN to the M tuple AI1, AI2 and so on up to AIM, where M is less than N. In other words, a projection keeps the m components of the n tuple and deletes its n minus m other components. Now, what is the result when we apply this projection P2,4 to the student record? Now, what happens is, if relating, if I am writing P 2 comma 4, so that is when we write P 2 comma 4 or actually subscript P 2 comma 4, then it means it is taking the second attribute and the fourth attribute and deleting these attributes. Okay. Similarly, if I am writing for P 1 comma 4, for the table that we have seen earlier, if I am writing for this table P 1 comma 4. Okay. Now when we take P 1 comma 4, the resultant table will have only student name and GPA. Let's see the resultant table. This table 2 is actually the resultant table, which is the operation of P 1 comma 4. That is, if we write P 1 comma 4 for our table 1, which we have seen, then it is removing the ID column and also the major column and keeping only the student name and the GPA. Now, on this table, table 3, the table 3 is enrollments. Now, on this, if we write the projection 1, 2 on table 3, we have the following result. That is, why do we have only 3 rows over here, although we have so many rows in table 3? Because the names are being repeated. Grosser is repeated thrice, Marcus is repeated thrice, and Miller is repeated twice. And so that is the reason we only have 3 rows and the respective majors of those students. In some cases, applying a projection to an entire table may not only result in fewer columns, but also in fewer rows, as we have seen in our earlier example. Some records may only have differed in those fields that were deleted, so they become identical and there is no need to list the duplicate records. Now, the next is join operations. So by now we have seen the different operations on NRE relation, and this join operation is actually the last one. So just to summarize, we have seen the first one is selection operator. The second one is projection operator, and the third one is join operation. We can use the join operation to combine two tables into one if they share some identical fields. Let R be a relation of some degree M and S, a relation of degree N. The join of R, S, where we have to follow a certain condition, will be given as follows. So this actually definition is a bit confusing. It is better to see an example for the same. So suppose if we have these two tables, basically join is joining of tables. And if we have these two tables, table 5 and table 6, table 5 has the name of the professor, department and the course number, while table 6 has the department, course number, room and time. Now, what relation results when the join operator is used to combine the relation displayed in table 5 and 6? So what will happen is, we will get the attributes or the columns as follows. I'll just make a small table over here. We will get a professor column, a department column, a course number, and then we will get room and time. Now, who is the professor? We have Professor Cruz, Zolgi, and the course number is 335. Then we have to write the resultant room number and also the time 9 a.m. Then similarly for this one, Zolgi 412, room number again is the same and the time is 8 a.m. So this way you will have to create a entire joined table, which will be as follows. So this is the resultant table that we get when we join the table 5 and table 6. I hope you can create it by yourself. This is not very complicated or confusing. And also, this is just the basics of the new subject that you will be studying later on, which is database management systems. So here you will just study an introduction of these topics. The next topic is representing relations. So in this section, actually, we will discuss two methods of representing relations. One method uses the 0-1 matrices and the other is, let's just write it, 0-1 matrix. And the other is the pictorial representation, which is the directed graph. So we will be using graphs to represent relations. Generally, matrices are appropriate for the representation of relations in computer programs. On the other hand, when as we are doing the representation, so 0-1 matrices are good for computers, while suppose if we are doing it, so for us, directed graphs are useful for understanding the properties of the relation. Let's see this. So we already know the different ways of representing the relations. A relation between these sets can be represented by two ways, 0-1 matrices and directed graphs. If R is a relation from A, which has the elements A1, A2, and so on up to AN, and to B, which has the elements B1, B2, and so on up to BN, then R can be represented by the 0-1 matrix MR. So the matrix M on relation R is represented by MIJ. What are the elements MIJ? If MIJ is equal to 1, if the ordered pair AI and BJ belongs to R, and MIJ is equal to 0 if AI BJ does not belong to R. Now, what does this mean? In other words, the 0-1 matrix representing R has a 1 at its IJ entry when AI is related to BJ, and 0 in the matrix if AI is not related to BJ. For creating this matrix, we first need to list the elements in A and B in a particular but arbitrary order. Now, what is that? How can we represent the relation 2, 1, 3, 1, 3, 2 as a 0-1 matrix? For this, let's write this. Let R be the relation. R is the relation from A to B, containing A comma B if A belongs to capital A. Okay, so the ordered pair is small a comma B, and small a should belong to capital A, while the lowercase b should belong to the set B, and A is greater than B. If you notice, 2 is greater than 1, 3 is greater than 1, and 3 is greater than 2. What is the matrix representing R? If A1 here is equal to 1, A2 is equal to 2, A3 is 3, and B1 is equal to 1, B2 is equal to 2. That is here, set A has the elements 1, 2, 3. Set B has the elements 1, 2. Okay. Now for R, representing R, what we will do is, we will take the matrix MR as follows. So the rows will be written as 1, 2, 3 of set A. These are the rows. And what will be the column? The columns will be 1, 2 of set B. Okay. Now, what should be the content of the matrix? Do we have a relation 1, 1 here in this R? No. So it will be 0. Do we have a relation 1, 2? 1, 2. No. So this is also 0. Do we have a relation 2, 1? Yes, 2, 1 exists. So it will be 1. 2, 2, is it there? No. So this will be 0. Then we have 3, 1. Yes, 3, 1 is in our relation R. So yes. Then 3, 2 is also in the relation R. So it is 1. So basically, whatever ordered pair is in the relation R, we will put the value as 1. while the ordered pair which are not an arc will be given as the value 0. So the zeros show that this is not our relation. The ones show that our relation is this. Hence, the matrix MR is given by the following, which I have already given you. This is the solution. Now, the next thing is, what do we know about the matrices representing a relation on a set? So, a relation from A to A. What about those kind of matrices? So, for those kind of matrices, they are square matrices. And what about the matrices which are representing reflexive relations? All the elements on the diagonal of such matrices must be 1s. So for reflexive, suppose I am taking this matrix, let me take A, set A as 1, 2, 3. And for this, if I create a reflexive relation, it will have 1, 1, 2, 2 and 3, 3. And our relation is on A cross A. That is, our relation is based on the same A and A set. So in this case, if I want to create a matrix, I will have 1, 2, 3 over here, 1, 2, 3. And when you are writing this in the examination, don't write these 1, 2, 3. It is understood. Now, 1, 1 exists. So let's put a 1. What about 2, 2? Also 1. 3, 3, 1. All the other values will be 0. So this is basically a diagonal matrix with all ones, or I believe you even call it an identity matrix. So reflexive relations are usually the matrices which have diagonal elements as 1. Now if you have 4 elements, again the 4th element will be also 1. This way. Let me just clear this. So this way all the diagonal elements will be 1. Let's take another example. Let A is equal to A1, A2, A3. So instead of numbers, we have these A1, A2, A3, and then B is equal to B1, B2, B3. B4 and B5. Then which ordered pairs are in the relation R, which are being represented by the matrix MR is equal to. So in this case, we have been given the matrix and not the relation. So we have to find the relation based on the matrix. The matrix is given as follows: 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. Now in this case, this will be our A1, A2, A3, and these are B1, B2, B3, B4 and B5. Now whichever value has 1, we will form that ordered pair. So let's write the relation R. A1, B1 is 0. A1, B2, since it has a 1, A1 and B2, and then A2 and B1, A2, B3, A2, B4, A3, B1, A3, B3, and A3, B5. And also, you can create any matrix based on these two sets, and you can create a relation on your own. Now, what about the matrices representing symmetric relations? These matrices are symmetric matrices. That is, the transpose of the matrix is equal to itself. So, actually, the symmetric relations are, if you remember, if AB is in R, then BA should also be in R. BA should belong to R. If AB belongs to R, BA should also belong to R. So, this property, if the relation is satisfying, it is symmetric, and these matrices are symmetric, that is, the transpose is equal to the matrix itself, this way. So if you create the transpose of the matrix, then you will get the same matrix MR. That is, you are changing the rows and columns. Symmetric matrix, and we get the symmetric relation. And this is a non-symmetric matrix. So if we create the transpose, we will get all the ones in the top two rows, and then all zeros in the columns below, in the rows below. So that is, it is a non-symmetric matrix, and also it is a non-symmetric relation. Now, the Boolean operations join and meet. So we have already studied the Boolean operations join and meet. I believe we studied it in the chapter matrix operations in unit 1. I hope you remember. Can be used to determine the matrices representing the union and intersection of two relations respectively. So basically, join is used for union. So we have studied in the earlier class R1 union R2, R1 intersection R2. So those two can be represented using matrices by using this join and meet. To obtain the join of 2, 0, 1 matrix, we apply the Boolean OR function to all corresponding elements in the matrices. And to obtain the meet, we apply the AND function or the intersection. Now let's see with this, with the help of an example. Let the relations R and S be represented by the matrices MR and MS is given. Now we have to perform the join and meet. So to perform join is basically MR1 union R2, which will be given as MR1 or MR2. And if we want to perform the intersection MR1 intersection R2, it will be given as MR1 intersection MR2. Okay. Let's see the, what are the matrices representing R union S and R intersection S. So instead of R1, R2, here we have taken R and S. These matrices are given by this way. So here we are taking the OR of these two. 1 or 1 will give us 1, 0 or 0 will give 0, 1 or 1, 1 again, 1, 0, 1, 0 or 1, 1, 0 or 1, 1. And for the same way, if you are performing intersection, you will have MR intersection MS, or you will be, this will be the meet. While we studied 0, 1 matrices, we also studied something known as Boolean product of the matrix. So it was similar to the matrix multiplication. Now, if you can recollect it, we will look into the Boolean product concept with respect to relations. So do you remember the Boolean product of 2, 0, 1 matrix? So if A is equal to Aij is a 0, 1 matrix with m rows and k columns, and B is a matrix with k rows and n columns, then the Boolean product was denoted by A circle B, and it was a matrix of m cross n with the ijth entry as shown as follows. So each time, how we did in the matrix multiplication, A plus B into A plus C. In this way, we do here A and B or and follows. So over here, we will see the matrix multiplication with the help of an example. So let's take an example and see the same. Now, why do we need this Boolean product? So the Boolean product is needed to represent the composite of a relation. In the earlier class, we have studied composite of relation. For that reason, we need the Boolean product. So the composite of a relation is represented by the Boolean product. Let's take an example. Find the matrix representing S. R is composite to S, where the matrices R and S are denoted as MR is equal to, so the relation is given as 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And similarly, MS is given as 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, and 101. Now for the Boolean product, it is given, the Boolean product of these two will be given as, it is represented by the following. And if we want to take the Boolean product, we have to multiply this row with this column, how we usually do it in matrix multiplication. So please try to solve it. It is the matrix multiplication, and I'll directly give the answer over here. This will be equal to the resultant matrix after matrix multiplication, or the Boolean product is as follows: 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0. So this is the result. This matrix represents the composite of two relations. Now similarly, we will get, so for MC, if we want to find the composite, it will be MA composite MB, and the same is represented over here. So in terms of the relations, this means that C contains a pair XI, ZJ if and only if there is an element YN such that XI, YN is in relation A and YN, ZJ is in relation B. So this concept is basically the concept of composite relations. You can go back and refer to that topic and understand this definition. So instead of AB, BC over here, they have taken XI, ZJ, and this I and J denotes the row and the column respectively. So it is easier if you just go and look back to this topic, composite relations. Now therefore, C is equal to B circle A composite of A and B. Now the next thing is the same thing I have shown you with the help of an example. In other words, the matrix representing the composite of relations A and B is the Boolean product of the matrices representing A and B. Similarly, we can find the matrices representing the powers of relations. So if you remember, R square was given as R circle R. R cube is R square circle R. And this way we can go on. Rn. Mrn is given as Mr power n, nth Boolean power. Find the matrix representing R square, where matrix representing R is given by Mr is equal to 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. Now for this, if we want to find R square, it will be given as R circle R or R Boolean product R. So for this R Boolean product R, what you are supposed to do is multiply this matrix with itself, and the result will be as follows. So the matrix for R square is given by MR square is equal to MR square. So you will get the following result. Please solve it by yourself. It is simple matrix multiplication. Now, the next is representing relations using diagraphs. So earlier, all the topics that we have covered are with using matrices. So in the first we have seen that we can represent relations by two ways. One is by matrix and the other is by diagraph. So now we will be seeing how we can represent relations by using diagrams. So diagraphs is basically directed graph. And this is the pictorial representation for a finite set. So a directed graph or a diagraph consists of a set of vertices V together with a set of edge E. So we have vertices and edges, and whenever we want to create edges, those are the ordered pairs. So if A comma B we have, then we take two vertices A and B and create an edge between them to show A comma B. So from A to B, we will have to write the direction from A to B. So this is the vertex A and this is the vertex B. So the vertex A is called the initial vertex. So this vertex, because we have it in the pair, it is the first one. So it is known as the initial vertex, while B is called the terminal vertex. So this is the definition. directed graph or digraph consists of a set V of vertices or nodes together with a set E of ordered pairs of elements of V called edges or arcs. So vertices are also known as nodes and edges are also known as arcs. The vertex A is called the initial vertex of the edge A, B, and the vertex B is called the terminal vertex of this edge. We can use arrows to show the direction and to display the graph. So let's see with the help of an example. Display the digraph with V is equal to A, B, C, D. So V is the vertices and the edges is your relation. A, B, A, D, B, 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 D, C, A, C, B, and D, B. Now, first and foremost, we have to take the four vertices as follows. So we will take the vertex A, B, C, and D as follows. So take four vertices. Vertices are denoted by circles or dots. After that, for arrows, we will take a general arrow that we usually take from A to B. So the direction should be from A to B. Or else you can even mark the direction in between this way, A to B. Now after that, we have A to D. So A to D. Similarly, you can mark the direction over here also. So generally, when you are following a prescribed test, your prescribed textbook, the direction will be given in this way. So AB, AD. Then we have B to B. So what about B to B? So from B, the edge should end at B again. So this is actually called a loop. This is a loop. So from B to B. Whenever we have this kind of pair, then it will always create a loop. A to A will also, if we had A to A, it would have created a loop on A. The next thing will be B to D and C to A, C to B, and finally D to B. So this is the digraph for the relation given. Now similarly, here the edge is called a loop as I have already mentioned. Now the next question is, what is the relation for the directed graph? So over here in the question, we have been given the directed graph. We want to find the relation. So the same way as I have started in the earlier problem, you will see over here. So from 1 to 2, do we have a relation? No. And always it is better if we have numbers or alphabets, better to take it in a lexicographic order. That is, if we have numbers, better to proceed with 1, 2, 3, 4 in order so that you don't miss any pair. Similarly, if you have A, B, C, D, proceed in alphabetical order so that you don't miss any pair. So let's see for 1, 2, so we have four vertices. First and foremost, we will see for 1, 1. Do we have a loop? No, so there is no 1, 1. Next, 1 to 2. The direction is from 2 to 1, but not from 1 to 2. So we won't have 1, 2 also. Next, 1, 3. So this one, this edge is 1 to 3. So we have written 1 to 3 over here. Now for 1 to 4, this is the edge. 1 to 4 is written. After that, we have 2. Do we have 2, 1? Yes, this is 2, 1 written over here. Next, we have 2, 2. Similarly, 2, 2 is written over here. Then we have 2, 3, 2, 3. Now the next will be 3. So first we have to look for 3 to 1. Yes, from 3 to 1, we have this edge, 3, 1. Then next we have 3, 2. Do we have an edge from 3 to 2? No, we have an edge from 2 to 3, but not the other way. So 3, 3. Next, so we have a loop on 3, so 3, 3. Next, we will move on to 4, 1 and 4, 3. This way, whenever the directed graph is given, you can write the relation. So we have seen both the methods. When a relation is given, how to draw a directed graph. And when a directed graph is given, how to write a relation. Here also, 2, 2 and 3, 3 are loops, while all the other pairs are the edges. So obviously, we can represent any relation R on a set A by the digraph with A as its vertices and all pairs A, B belongs to R as its edges. And any digraph with vertices V and edges E can be represented by a relation as we have already seen. This one-to-one correspondence between relations and digraphs means that any statement about relations also applies to digraphs. That is, if we have got a problem on relations, that problem can also be solved using